What's going on, my good people? Mike Hidalgo here. Thank you for joining us on another FCP Euro DIY. Today, we're going to be working on a 2008 Mercedes-Benz W211 E63 AMG. Today on the W211, we're going to be covering how to replace the water pump on your M156 engine. This is going to be applicable to all vehicles equipped with the M156. In front of me, we have a genuine Mercedes-Benz water pump that comes pre-equipped with pre-fitted with a gasket. And we have some Rova coolant, which is going to be an OE replacement for the genuine Mercedes-Benz fluid. Again, this is the blue coolant. That's what these models take. All these parts are available on fcpeuro.com. Now, some things to know when you're going to replace a water pump is the health of them. Usually, these are one of the ones that we recommend you replace on an as-needed basis. These pumps come equipped with a weep hole. As they age and start to fail, you'll notice some coolant leaking out of there. That's a good indicator that it's time to replace it. In some other situations, you may hear some bearing noise or some squeaking. You can always check and grab the water pump pulley and check for some shaft play. If there's any play here, then more than likely the bearing has failed. If you hear some squeaking noise at idle, then that's another sign that this is going out. And in an extreme situation, the pump will fail completely. It will not circulate the coolant, or the gasket will fail and you'll lose coolant and your coolant light will come on. So we're gonna cover how to replace that today. But before we get started on that, let's take a look at some of the tools we're gonna need for this DIY. For this DIY, we're gonna be using a small torque wrench. We have a 17 millimeter socket. A 16 will work as well. This is gonna be for the tensioner. We have an 8 mil, a 10 mil. We have a T30. I'm using a 3/8 to 1/4 inch adapter as I'm using a 3/8 drive ratchet today. I also have a T45 as well as a T50 and an E12. We have another small 2-inch extension. I have some pliers that are gonna help us remove some plastic rivets as well as some pliers that'll help us release the petcock on the radiator. I have, along with that, as I mentioned, a 3/8 drive ratchet, a small pick, a flathead screwdriver. And then some nice to haves, but not totally mandatory, is a hammer and some liquid moly ceramic paste. As you can see, when we get started, our water pump is pretty crusty and the shaft on it, the end of it, is pretty corroded. So more than likely, our pulley is gonna be stuck to it. So we'll need those too. And then some nice to haves, in addition to that, is an electric ratchet just to speed up the removal and install of hardware. And the paint and pen, should you wanna mark down all the hardware after you torque them up. With that said, don't forget a catch pan, always necessary whenever you're gonna be draining coolant. Now with that, let's go ahead and get started on this DIY. All right, to get started, we're underneath the W211. We're gonna want to remove this forward front splash shield, which is held on by 8 8-millimeter bolts. So with an 8-millimeter socket on the electric ratchet, I'm gonna go ahead and zap off the 4 underneath. We have 2 in either fender liner. And now with all of our hardware removed, we can go ahead and pull down the back end of the shield gently. Now with the shield out of the way, we can go ahead and access our petcock and work on draining the coolant out of the radiator. All right, my good people, we have a catch pan situated under our petcock, which is located right here inside of this cooler hose. Sometimes they'll have a factory marking like this one does in yellow, just kind of shows you that the petcock is lined up and locked in place. There's a small drain port underneath where most of the coolant's going to be coming out of. Now I recommend you use a small hose if you can and attach it to that nipple so that you can kind of guide where the coolant's gonna exit. I have a random hose extension that came out of a CTA kit, CTA 7079. And it just has different hoses for the syringe tool that they sell. It just so happens to have a rubber end that fits nicely on the grommet. So, or on the nipple, I should say. So we're gonna go ahead and slip that on. Just like that. We'll guide our hose into our catch pan. And then I'm gonna use some pliers just to break that locking tab free. You wanna twist it counterclockwise. And then as you undo it, it'll increase the volume of coolant that comes out of that nipple. All right, we're gonna let that do its thing. One thing to note, speed up the process a little bit. You wanna release the cap on the expansion tank just so that you can break the vacuum seal and let the coolant flow out a little bit easier. All right, at this point you can see our line is pretty much clear. It's drained out for the most part. We're gonna go ahead and resecure our petcock, lock that back in. You can hear it click once it clicks in all the way. Remove the hose if you're using one, or your bucket or catch pan. Now that we're done draining our coolant, we're gonna go ahead and lower the car back on the ground with the shield off. And we're just gonna set a catch pan on the ground so that we can catch any more coolant that may drip down while we're working. Let's go ahead and get back up top. All right, to continue on this water pump DIY, we're gonna start by getting some things out of our way up here, starting with this beauty cover. Release it on either end of the air box by lifting up and pushing the tabs up that hold it into place. Just to kind of get it started. And you can just pull this off, set it to the side. Next, we're gonna work on removing the fan shroud so we have more than enough room to work with. To start, we're gonna peel up this weather stripping seal. Same thing, just rest it back. We don't have to take the whole thing off. With that, you have some rivets that you wanna remove. There's a total of four traditionally, one on this seal, one on the other seal, and then usually you have two down here that hold some more weather stripping. These are obviously missing, so we'll just work on removing these two. Next, we have a total of seven 10 millimeter bolts to remove. We have three on either end, and then we have one in the center by the hood latch. We have two T30s to remove, and now we should be able to lift this up gently and pull it off and set it to the side. You want to make sure when you reinstall this later that both of these rubber grommets are secured and they lock back on top of your radiator. That's what kind of keeps everything in place from moving and dancing around. So we'll set this to the side and then we'll continue on the fan shroud removal. Next, we're going to go ahead and disconnect our electrical connector that leads down to our electric fan. Simply push on either tab and pull the connector back. You can tuck that behind the ducting over here. Just kind of leave it out of the way. Next, we have a metal U-clip, one on either end of the radiator and fan shroud that hold these two units together. You can use a small flathead screwdriver and just work them up, pry it off. This is what that clip looks like. Flat end on the radiator side, hooked end on the fan shroud side. Now we have our electrical harness undone and our two metal clips removed. All that we have left to do before we pull this up is release the two coolant lines that are clipped into the bottom of the shroud. So let's take a peek underneath and we'll work on freeing those up. All right, underneath the fan shroud, we have a coolant line to unclip from the shroud. So let's go ahead and do that. On the passenger side bank, it's on the lower right corner. Then heading over to the driver's side. Still, well, it popped out with the other one, but traditionally, it is held in like that. This pops right out. And then we have one more clip that hugs the coolant line to the shroud. Just break this tab open, or free it open, I should say, using a flathead screwdriver. There we go. With those three connections freed up, now we can head back up top and pull the shroud out. Ours is a little broken here, but this should be traditionally even all the way across. The goal is to kind of push away from the radiator while you pull up. The key here is to gently push the radiator hose over to the side so you can clear this nub right here. Once that one's freed up, the whole shroud will come up. With the fan shroud out of the way, our next move is going to be to get the power steering reservoir out of our way just to give us some better breathing room so we can see everything and have an easier access to the belt when we pull it off, as well as the pump once we pull it off. So let's start by removing this vacuum line up top that goes to these two valves. This one's just clipped into place in the reservoir, and then you free them from the valves by pulling back. Just set it to the side. Next, we're gonna go ahead and remove the bolt that holds our power steering reservoir in place. It's held in by one T30. And before we pry the reservoir out, we just wanna free the two lines that go to it from this grommet by the oil filter housing. These just simply pop out. Pretty straightforward. Now we can work on removing this vacuum line back here That's just clipped into our power steering reservoir as well. If you'd like, you can remove it from the valve. However, you don't have to. You can just pull it up. Oh, well, here we go. This one's separated from the elbow, so that'll make our life easier. Just tuck it away. Now we can work on working up this reservoir. And that's as far as we're gonna move it. It's just so that we have some more breathing room when we remove these tensioner pulleys. If you want, you can pull off this expansion tank line, which I'll show you how to remove real quick. Just has a clip that you pull up on. And then you pull it back. That'll give you some more breathing room. Just be very gentle with this. They are pretty delicate. And as they get older, they get pretty brittle. Okay, beautiful. Before we go ahead and remove our belt, we want to break free the water pump pulley bolts. You have four T30s that you want to break free. You don't have to remove them, just get them started. Using a 17 millimeter socket, we're going to use this to release the tension on our tensioner and remove our belt. Release the tension and get your belt off. Perfect. I'm gonna go ahead and pull off the belt. Next, we're gonna work on removing these two pulleys that are bolted to the water pump, starting with the one underneath our thermostat. We're gonna need a T50 for that one. Go ahead and break it free. One thing to note about the new water pump is typically the bolts come untapped for the pulleys. So you're gonna wanna use your hardware to tap the new pump housing, or you can use a tap and die set, whichever is easier for you. Just note that when you get that water pump, you don't wanna freak out and see, hey, there's no threads in here. That's just how they come from the factory. They expect you to tap them as you install your new hardware or your hardware back in. Then an E12 for the next one. And now we can work on removing the pump pulley. T30, again, these should be pretty loose as we broke them free before we took off the belt. And then once we get this pulley off, we can work on getting the water pump off itself. Sometimes these can seize on a little bit due to corrosion. You might have to grab a small flathead or something and pry it off. So what we did was sprayed some penetrating fluid on it. So you can see the head of this water pump's pretty rusty. More than likely our pulley is just seized on by rust. So we're gonna give it a couple whacks with the hammer and see if that broke it free. Again, because we're replacing the water pump, I'm not too worried about damaging the shaft or the bearing in there. However, the water pump pulley itself we're gonna be retaining, so we wanna be careful not to damage that in the process. Using a rubber mallet here. There we go. We'll set this off to the side and we'll clean it up nicely. Now, before we start removing our water pump, there's one more tensioner that sits underneath the thermostat that's held in by a T50. You're gonna wanna remove that one so you have easy access to the T30 behind it. You can squeeze one in there, but there's no point in risk stripping that. All right, we can set this to the side. Before we work on getting the pump off, you're gonna wanna disconnect this lower radiator hose. Quick clip, just pry it open with a flathead screwdriver or a small pick tool. You can also remove the clip like that if you'd like. And that's why we keep a catch pan under there. All right. We're gonna go around with the T30 bit on our ratchet and just break all the T30s free first. It shouldn't be very tight as they don't take a lot of torque. One thing I recommend, my good people, is if you have your new pump laying next to you, you can start feeding in the hardware into the new one so you can keep it organized. Or you can make yourself a cardboard, trace the new pump, and just start poking the bolts through where the hardware is supposed to go, as they're all different lengths. That's what we're gonna do here. So we'll show you that as we have all our hardware in it. With all our T30s removed, now we're gonna move around to doing the T45s, starting up top. We have one sneaky T30 in here that we can't forget about. That one we'll pull out with the pump stuck in that recessed hole. And we have one last T45. We can pull the pump off. Here's a better look at where that sneaky T30 sits. Sits underneath the left side tensioner opening. Before we install our new pump, I'm gonna take a light Scotch pad and just scrape off any of the residual gasket left behind. I'm barely putting any pressure on this. I have my pad soaked in a little bit of all-purpose cleaner so that it's a little bit moist, and it kind of just traps in any debris that may come off instead of having it turn into light dust and contaminate our cooling system. All right, then we just want to wipe down all our surfaces and make sure everything's nice, clean, and dry, and ready for our new pump. Here's that diagram that I drew up real quick, or sketch, if you will, of the old water pump. And even though a lot of the hardware is the same size, they're in different spots. So you have T45s intermixed with T30s. For me, it was easier to just lay them out in the same way that I took them out. So I'll be using this to feed my new hardware in the same way it came out. So without further ado, let's go ahead and install our new water pump. All right, we have our water pump ready to go. Gasket's already on it. That's how it comes from Mercedes. We're gonna set our water pump into place and line it up with the two dowel pins that hold it against the block. Helps align everything. And we'll start with the top T45. Just get it in there by hand. And then with that one, just hand tight, it should hold the whole pump in place. Then we can continue feeding the rest of our hardware in by hand. We'll start with the four T45s first. Our second one. And our last T45 by our alternator. And now we can go ahead and torque these four down if we want. We'll hit them with some paint pens. That way we know those are all set. We're gonna go ahead and torque all four of our T45s down to 20 Newton meters. I'm gonna do them in a cross pattern. So I just did my top one. I'm gonna do my lower left by the alternator. And then we have one down below. Beautiful. I'm gonna hit those all with the little paint mark. That way I know they're all torqued up. Now we can go ahead and install our T30s. Same thing, we're gonna feed all of these by hand first, and then we'll go ahead and torque them down. Our longest one sat right below the thermostat. Because these take such a low torque value, I'm gonna put them in all by hand. While I could use the electric ratchet, that may over torque them accidentally, so I'd rather just put them in gently by hand. We'll snug them up, and then we'll just go in with the torque wrench at the end. The one underneath the very longest one is also the shortest one. All right, with all those snug up by hand, now we're gonna go around and torque them down to 9 Newton meters. We'll start at the top and we'll work our way around. The pump shouldn't get sunk in too much more, as our T45s already did that for us. So we can just go in a round order here. All right, baby, she is all torqued down. At this point, you're more than welcome to hit him with the little mark. I think it looks nice whenever you have some fresh new parts installed that you have to torque down. Gives it a more professional appearance, and it all just also just helps you. In this case, we don't expect these to come loose, but should this be some suspension components or something similar, that'd be more critical. It would definitely be a good thing to have these marked up. With our water pump bolted in, our next step is going to be to reinstall our water pump pulley. Before installing this pulley, if you remember, the pulley was seized onto our old water pump pretty well, so I went ahead and added a little bit of liquid moly ceramic paste on there just to keep it from rusting. So then the next time someone does this job, they have an easier chance at getting this pulley off. Get our bolt holes lined up. And then we can start threading this in by hand. Once we have our belt back on, we'll torque these down. But for now, we're gonna leave these finger tight. And then I also recommend you wipe off the pulley with some sort of degreaser or cleaner in case you got anything on it. You don't wanna get your belt contaminated or make it squeak, or even worse, have it slip off. So let's go ahead and wipe that down. Now with that situated, we can go ahead and reconnect our lower radiator hose. Now, before I reinstall the radiator hose, I recommend, if you can, to replace the seals if you're not replacing the hoses. They get pretty flat over time, and it's just another place where these can leak potentially. We have a link in the description below for them. You just pull the old one off with a small flathead or pick, slide your new one on, and it never hurts to lubricate that a bit with some coolant. Dab a bit of fresh coolant on the O-ring to help it seat in so it doesn't get pinched on the way in. Our new water pump came with a new clip. You remember we dropped the old one, we don't need it. For the new one, we're simply gonna keep the clip engaged on the water pump. We're not gonna pull it out. And then we're just gonna simply feed it into place. There's alignment dowels on either side of the hose. You can see one on this side has the same one on the other side. Make sure you feed those in the same shape of the water pump. And there we go. Both sides clipped in. Give it a gentle pull, but now she's nice and secure. Now our next step is going to be to install or reinstall our tensioners. Again, as I mentioned, these aren't usually tapped from Mercedes. You're going to have to tap them with the same hardware that you're installing, or you can use a tap and die set. We'll install with the left one here, and then we'll work our way over to the right one. Mercedes was kind enough to pre-tap the left tensioner, so we can go ahead and reinstall that one. I'm going to use my E12 on my ratchet just to snug it up, and then we're going to torque this down to 30 newton meters. 30 newton meters, E12. There we go. Now we're going to go ahead and get ready to tap our bolt into our fresh housing. If you look at the hardware that you removed, or if you're replacing the tensioner, you can see that the bolts have a tapered head. They start out really thin and then work their way up to normal size. That's what helps cut these, so you may have to work it back and forth. The goal here is to keep the bolt as straight as possible so you don't end up trying to tap this at a crooked angle. That should be pretty good. I'll go ahead and back this out, and then we'll put our idler pulley back on. We'll snug it up with the electric ratchet, and then we'll torque it down to 20 newton meters. Again, T50 for this one. Torque it to 20. There we go. And last but not least, we have the last tensioner that sits below our thermostat housing. We can put that one back in as well. Same thing, we'll get this one set into place, and then we'll just thread it in by hand first. We'll snug it up with the electric ratchet, and we'll torque it down to 20 newton meters, just like we did the other one. There we go. Now we're gonna go ahead and feed our belt back on. We left this one on our AC pulley earlier, so we didn't have to do too much redoing here. All right, so what I like to do now I'm putting the belt back on is I like to leave it at the easiest spot for me to feed it back on. So what I mean by that is I have it situated around the tensioner already, around my accessories, my crank, and some of my idler pulleys as well. What I'm going to do is once I start putting or releasing the tension on the tensioner, it's easier for me to just feed it over this top grooved pulley than it is to have to fumble with it on the tensioner while I also have a tool on it. So I'll keep tension on this one by hand. I'll grab my 17 millimeter socket and we'll get ready to lower the tension on the tensioner. Put our 17 back on, take the tension off, slide our belt in place. And with that, our belt is back on and secure, my good people. Now that we have our belt on, we can go ahead and tighten down our four water pump pulley bolts. Again, those are T30s. We're gonna torque these to 8.5 newton meters, not a whole lot. Now with that situated, we can reinstall our power steering reservoir and our expansion tank coolant line. We're just gonna take our pump, feed it back into place. Sink it back into that rubber grommet that holds it in place. Don't forget your vacuum line if you disconnected it or just removed it. Tuck that behind the reservoir into that little metal clip. We can reinstall our T30. We're just gonna snug this one up with the ratchet, but if you wanna torque it, following along at home, no more than 7 to 10 newton meters for this. Don't forget to tuck your lines back into their respected grommets over here that hold them into place. As well as your coolant line. If you remove that earlier, you want to plug that back in underneath your reservoir here to the thermostat. Lock it in with that metal clip. Feed it back into its respective grommet. Now we can reattach our vacuum line to the two EGR solenoids. Clip that onto the reservoir. Clip the line back into its grommet. And now at this point, we can reinstall our fan shroud and then continue on with this water pump DIY. Just be mindful of that radiator hose on your right side bank. You want to massage it a little bit to the side to get this fan shroud in if it gets in your way. All right, as you bring the fan shroud down, you want to make sure you lock it into those two bottom tabs that we showed you earlier underneath the car. We'll point them out again when we get underneath to resecure the belly splash shield as well as the cooling hose that runs along the shroud. All right, my good people, back underneath the W211, we're gonna make sure our fan shroud is aligned in place, and then we're gonna reclip in that coolant line that runs through the shroud, so let's do that. So you can see our fan shroud is situated back in the radiator on the clip that holds it into place, so that's great. We'll go ahead and seat our coolant line back into the shroud while we're over here. Simply pop it back into place. So you can see our fan shroud situated on the driver's side bank as well. We have that coolant line up top that we need to reclip. We use a screwdriver to just swing that clip around so we can get that around the hose and clip it back into itself. So again, it sits above the connector for the fan. I'm just gonna reach up there for a moment and clip it closed, and then I'll show you what that looks like once again. Also gonna pop our line back here in place, so it's not fighting us up top. There we go. With that situated, now we can go ahead and reinstall this front shield. So again, kind of like the way we took it out, key it into the bumper first, make sure it sits underneath this intermediate shield, and then we can put our 8mm hardware back on. I'm gonna start with the two rearward 8mm so I can hold both of these shields together and in place. We'll just hand start them for now, finger tight. I'll zap these four in real quick with the 8mm on the electric ratchet. And then we have four more, two on either fender liner. All right, with this bottom shield situated, now we can head back up top and reinstall our radiator support. So let's go ahead and do that. All right, back up top, we're gonna work on securing our fan shroud to the radiator, and then our radiator support can go back in. Starting with either end of the fan shroud, we have two metal body clips that we removed earlier. Now would be the time to reinstall those. And again, the back side of the clip is going to be facing the front of the vehicle, and then the curved end will be facing the engine. So pretty straightforward. They really only go in one way. There's one. There's two. While we have all the room to work with, we'll reconnect our electrical connector for the fan. There we go. When you reinstall the radiator support, you want to make sure your hood latch release cable is running outside of the channeled areas on the radiator so that you don't accidentally pinch the cable. And underneath the support itself, as I mentioned at the beginning, we have these red isolating rubber boots or rubber blocks that kind of help keep that in place as well as help with vibration. So you want to make sure those two key back into your radiator as well. Beautiful. Now we're gonna go ahead and hand start the seven 10mm bolts and our two T30s. And our two T30s. Then we're gonna go ahead and torque all of these down to 10 newton meters. Not a whole lot. You could just tighten them by hand, but we have the torque wrench out still, so let's go ahead and torque them down properly. We'll swap over to our T30 bit. Now we can take our weather stripping from earlier and tuck this back over the top here, along with these pesky rivets. Then we can reinstall our weather stripping back in place. Now we can go ahead and reinstall our beauty cover. For the beauty cover, just like we removed it, you wanna make sure the six tabs are aligned, two on each airbox, and then you have two up front here, one on the reservoir and one on the reservoir bracket. All right, and now that we have our beauty cover back on, we have one more big step left to do here, and that is gonna be to refill our coolant system. Now, what's awesome about these engines is that they're not very temperamental like the BMW vehicles are, or the Audis or Volkswagens. These are pretty easy. They're pretty much self-bleeding. So what we're gonna start by doing is filling up the reservoir as much as it'll take, obviously without overfilling. Then we're gonna hop inside the car. We'll show you, we'll turn it on, we'll put our heat on high, and then we're just gonna run the car around 1500 to maybe 1800 RPM for a little bit, kind of let the system self-bleed, and then we'll just top it off as it needs. So let's get to that. All right, my good people, we are ready to fill the coolant system. We have our funnel. We have our gallon of concentrated Rova coolant, as well as a gallon of distilled water in there. We highly recommend you use distilled whenever possible. It'll just cut down on the mineral deposit buildup in your coolant system over time, especially if you have hard water at home, you want to try to avoid using that. But with that being said, we have 2 gallons in here. We're going to start filling the system very slowly. We don't want to add any additional air pockets or create any air pockets as we're filling the system. So you don't want to just dump coolant all the way in. A nice gentle pour. Once we have a decent level in our expansion tank, we're gonna hop inside the car, we're gonna turn it on, and like I said, anywhere between 15 to 18, even 2000 RPM is good. And the goal is to get the car up to about 85 degrees Celsius on our gauge. That way we'll know the thermostat is open and the vehicle is circulating coolant all the way through, along with having our heater valves open. So let's do that and go from there. All right, she took almost all 2 gallons, so which is roughly about what we drained out of it. We're gonna save that extra in our Rova jug should we need to top it off. But for now, let's go ahead and leave this open. We're gonna hop inside the car, turn it on, get it up to temp, and go from there. All right, my good people, as you saw inside the vehicle, we got our temp up to 85 degrees Celsius, meaning we gave the thermostat a chance to open up and circulate the coolant. I also put the fan on high afterwards to make sure I was getting hot heat out of the vents, which we did. So at this point, all we have left to do is to put on our expansion tank cap and then go for a test drive. If you like this video, please be sure to give it a thumbs up. If you have any questions or comments on what we did today, leave them in the comment box below. And if you like this DIY and you want to see more like them, please consider subscribing. We make new ones all the time. As always, thank you so much for watching. We'll catch you on the next one.